now.
Not yet.
We are in face in YouTube.
We're on YouTube.
Facebook Live.
Okay, great. We're on both. Okay. All right. I'm recording. Okay. Check recording. Check Facebook and YouTube. Okay. Father's ready. Adele, can you turn your video off? Okay. Good evening, everyone. I'm John Kerwin, an assistant professor of theology and the director of the graduate theology program at the University of St. Thomas. And it is my honor to welcome you to the third lecture of the 2021 Truth in Tradition online lecture series sponsored by the graduate theology program at the University of St. Thomas. You can watch all the lectures live on our Facebook page or YouTube, UST Theology on YouTube or on Zoom. And all the live streaming links are on our website, realtheologyust.com. Also, if you have to leave early or you have friends that you would like to watch, but they can't make it, you can, the videos go straight to Facebook and YouTube as soon as they're over. So in case you miss one. It's a real pleasure to introduce tonight's speaker, my colleague, Father Dempsey Rosales Acosta. Father Dempsey is an associate tenured professor of biblical theology and the Miller Chair of Catholic Studies at the University of St. Thomas in Houston. After graduating in philosophy and pedagogy from the Catholic University of Cecilio Acosta in Venezuela, he obtained his baccalaureate in theology at the Pontifical Gregorian University in Rome, a degree in biblical sciences and languages at the Pontifical Biblical Institute in Rome, and a doctorate in biblical theology at the Pontifical Gregorian University in Rome. Since 2008, he has been a peritus consultant and collaborator of the presidential liaison of the Catholic Ministries of the American Bible Society and an expert consultant for the Conference of Catholic Bishops of the United States regarding the biblical translations of original texts. Father Dempsey has created and developed academic programs of biblical studies at the undergraduate and master's level in both Spanish and English for the formation of adults nationwide in the United States through the University of St. Thomas, Houston, also Loyola Marymount in Los Angeles, and the McGrath Institute for Church and Life at the University of Notre Dame. It's a real pleasure to have Father Dempsey. For those of you who have been around University of St. Thomas, you know that Father Dempsey is a much beloved professor. He's a much sought after professor. He won the very prestigious Aquinas Award for teaching, for excellence in teaching this year at UST. And his classes fill up early. And usually we have a joke in the theology department that when we see students meandering around the hallways looking for something, we just point them to Father Dempsey's office and assume that that's where they're going. So Father Dempsey, it's a real pleasure to have you here. Thank you so much for clearing your busy schedule to give us these words of wisdom. And I will turn it over to you.
Thank you so much. I'm very honored to be here with you, Dr. Kerwin. And let us start with a prayer, because it's important always to place ourselves into the presence of the Lord. I have to talk about the mystery of God, you know, in this case about the tradition. So let us begin in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We give you thanks, O Lord, King of the universe, for this day, for this moment. Give us the strength and the serenity to continue to do your will and open our hearts and our minds so we can always be eager students of your love in our lives. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I would like to share with you my screen. I prepare PowerPoint so it will be easier then to follow, especially some important ideas. And also, I would like to show you some details that maybe you will be interested in, and then you can take notes of it. So the title is quite important, because at the end of the presentation, you will know the meaning. Why was my intention behind this title? Tradition in a Changing World, a Journey. Already when we talk about tradition, we need to think of something that is dynamic. Sometimes the common understanding, the simplistic understanding of tradition today is like it is something that is stuck, like it is something static or passive, but not in this case. This case is more complicated than that. When we talk about the Catholic tradition, the Christian tradition, and as a premise, it's important for us to highlight De Verbum number 6, very important. So please, this is a numeral that we need to keep always in our heads when we talk about the tradition, about the mystery of God and the revelation. So I read the text. Through divine revelation, God chose to show forth and communicate himself and the eternal decisions of his will regarding the salvation of man. That is to say, he chose to share with them those divine treasures, which totally transcend the understanding of the human mind. See, this very brief paragraph can be unpacked in so many theological axioms, theological principles that can be applied in all branches of theology, but also spirituality. First of all, we have to remember then that the mystery of God is always absolute and go beyond our understanding, beyond our comprehension. It's very important, but God, because he's a divine teacher, a divine pedagogos, throughout the history of salvation, he decides gradually how to teach us about himself. And how he does it? By communicating himself to us according to his will, according to the time that he decides is better, according to our evolution of understanding. So he arrived to a moment that he will present his divine treasures progressively, and those divine treasures arrive to a summit precisely with the person of Christ. In that moment, that we have the complete and full revelation of the Trinitarian God in the Son who is incarnated. And that complete revelation manifesting in the Son of God is just only a glimpse of the totality of the mystery of God. So here we have this idea then. So God is by far more of what we can understand of him. So that is why in Catholic theology, we have this principle since the early fathers of the church, and it was developed even more throughout the scholasticism and then actually in the magisterium. Deus semper maius est. God is always greater. Doesn't matter whatever we can say of him, whatever we can understand of him, always God is greater. It's by far magnificent and superior. So, but because we are created by the image of God, we have the imprint of God in our creation. By the human reason, we can get to the knowledge of God. We can arrive to the notion that there is something out there what we can call God according to the natural order of knowledge, right? But also there is another order of knowledge. And that order of knowledge is the one that comes from God himself, in which by the use of reason itself, we cannot arrive to that knowledge. So God and his wisdom and his will and his love for us, his self communicate to us, giving us a glimpse of that divine nature of what he is. So then by the use of natural reason, but also with the revelation, we can have the capacity to articulate, to express and give reason of the faith of the God that is always greater. And in the incarnation of the Son, then we have the summit, the complete full revelation of God in our history, according to our understanding. And then, my dear friends, we need then to start to explain that mystery. And that is the beginning of the tradition. Catholic Christian tradition starts with the event of the incarnated Son, the incarnated Logos, which is very important. By the way, I put these notions in the PowerPoint in front of you, natural reason, ratio naturalis, no? And the divine revelation as the other order of knowledge. And that actually is very well established in Dei Filius. For those of you who are studying theology, this is essential. Dei Filius is a dogmatic constitution, Council Vatican I, but nevertheless is reinterpreted at the same time, quoted and reestablished by Vatican Council II in the Dei Verbum. So that is why it's so important to keep these two notions in mind. So with this idea that I present to you as a premise, then it's important now to present or to try to explain briefly what we call in academia the theological phenomenon of tradition, all right? If the event of Christ, the incarnation of the Logos, is actually the beginning of the tradition, is also the beginning of scripture. But I would like to use then scripture and magisterium, scriptura and magisterium, in order to explain this phenomenon of the Catholic tradition. What is a true Catholic tradition according to our own tradition, ironically, right? So let us begin there with the scripture, scriptura. In order to do Catholic theology, we have to have these three columns, always scriptura, traditio, et magisterium. But because I'm explaining traditio, tradition, of course. So I will use the other two columns so we can have a panoramic view. So let us start with Scriptura. And came to my mind a very important text that please highlight it, write it down, or put a note in your Bibles, if you have your Bibles there. And that is 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 to 26. Those verses, when we unpack them, they have so much information about history of the church, about liturgy. And of course, it is the perfect example of the dynamic dimension of tradition. So I read the text for you. For I received parelabon from the Lord, what I also handed on paredoka to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night he was handed over, took bread, and after he had given thanks, broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, also the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the death of the Lord until he comes." As you can tell, this is one of the oldest or the earliest versions of the words of the institution of the Eucharist that was transmitted as a catechetical formula or as some kind of a nutshell of a creed that has been transmitted, handed over faithfully by memory orally. Very important. So you will see that in the text that I presented to you, that I have two words that are highlighted in red. Very important, that color. Every time they highlight something red, it's because it's very important. So that's why you will see a lot of red sometimes. So there are two verbs that are essential in order to explain the theological dimension of tradition in Catholic theology. The first one is parelabon, what Paul says, I receive parelabon. Parelabon is an aorist conjugation of the verb paralambano. So that is why I presented to you right here, paralambano. So, okay, paralambano. Paralambano, when we go to the, when we go to the lexical in Greek, so paralambano have the following meanings, which are the most common ones: to take with oneself, to join to oneself, to receive. It's quite important, this, to join to oneself. So when I receive something, it's actually joined to me, attached to me, right? So it's very important, this. And then you do the other action, the paredoka, that Paul actually will talk. Paredoka is a very important verb. It's here is the aorist of the verb paradidomi that I transliterated for you. So I put the original and then the transliteration. When we go to the lexicon in Greek for paradidomi, we have the following meanings: to give into the hands of another, to give over into one's power or use, to deliver to one something to keep, to use, to take care of, or to manage. Very important. Remember that when I'm using the Greek lexicon, I'm using a Greek lexicon that is very much in use for the entire Greek literature, not just only Catholic or biblical, okay? So it's quite fascinating to see these connotations. Why? Why? I will explain this later on, but it's important to realize that the Christian vocabulary is on the making at the beginning of the first century. So what happened is that the biblical authors or the first Christians, they needed to borrow notions and concepts from the Greco-Roman culture in order to apply it with a new meaning to the event of Christ. So it's very important, this itself. And I want you to highlight, please forgive me, I'm going back very, very briefly, to the verb paradidomi. Okay, so please, I want you to highlight this, paradidomi, all right? Paradidomi, why? Because that is the verb that later on, or starting already in early Christianity, is the one that will predominate in order to talk about tradition, all right? The verb paradidomi. And the verb paradidomi implies simultaneously something that was received. And that is very unique and original, especially in the Christian tradition. To give implies that at the same time I have been receiving something. And now my mission is now to transmit the treasure that has been entrusted to me. Very important, this itself. That is why from the verb paradidomi began this very special word that for those of you who study theology, you should know this word very well, paradosis. Okay, so that's what I transliterated for you there. Paradosis. Please, 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 please. Paradosis is not paradox, all right? So do not confuse the word paradosis with the word paradox or paradoxa. There are two different words, all right? Two different etymologies. So it's important to keep this very clear. Paradosis is the noun form of the verb paradidomi, right? And in fact, paradosis, like paradidomi, is a compound word. So you have the preposition para, and para is a very rich preposition, very rich term in Greek. I mean, when you go to a lexicon, you have pages and pages, you know, of meanings. But in this case, the most proper one would be from, close, or beside, okay? And then didomi is the simple verb form to indicate to give, to hand over, right? So I hand over, I give something from, in this case from me, right? So this word paradosis is very common in the Greco-Roman world that is not Christian. So please pay attention to this, all right? It's very common in the Greco-Roman world that is not Christian. In fact, you will see the word paradosis apply in military context. So, and that implies the act of giving up or surrendering. For example, I surrender this city to my enemy, okay? Military context. You are going to see this, for example, in the writings of Polybius or even in Aristotle in the Politics, you know? Book 5. So I put the quotations there for you. So as examples, in Flavius Josephus in the famous Jewish Wars, he used it because he writes in Greek, even though the Flavius Josephus from the first century, paradosis as a way of surrender. So I give over my power, my city, okay, my forces, my army. But also it's quite fascinating, this one. I want you to highlight this. Also in the Greco-Roman world, that is not Christian, the term paradosis is applied very much so in context of education or educational context in which a teacher is giving over what has been done or what has been learned through oral transmission or written transmission, all right? So tradition is practically the essence of instruction. It's a narrative, it's a preset. So it's the equivalent to educate. So that is why Plato, in Laws, in this book of Laws, book 7, I put the quotation here for you and highlighting it for you. He used the word paradosis right here that I put in Greek with the word didaskalia as intertwined. Didaskalia means instruction, education. From that word didaskalia, we find the associated word didaskalos, the teacher, right? So paradosis, didaskalia. So quite fascinating. So what is the object of paradosis? Is actually the substance of teaching, the essence, the core of my teaching. Interesting. Now, my dear friends, this notion, especially the one that is very well in use in educational context, is the one that began to predominate in the Pauline spirituality, in the Pauline writings. It's the one that predominates in the early Christian communities when we talk about paradosis, when they talk about the tradition that has to be protected, that has to be transmitted, that have to be faithfully teach. So faithfully taught, okay? Very good then. So, but let us pay attention also to the other side of the coin. That I'm very sensitive to that. So remember that in the early Christianity, for example, Paul or the first Christians communities also, even though they are immersed in a Greco-Roman culture, they have a very solid root that is coming from Judaism, from the Semitic culture, Hebrew and Aramaic, especially in Paul, who was a polyglot in this aspect. So also in Hebrew or in Aramaic, we have this word, masorah or mesorah, very important. And that is the word that usually we translate as tradition in Judaism. So it's very important. So that is why you will hear this word, the Masoretes. The Masoretes, in Latin, Masoretas, okay, are the ones actually who wrote faithfully and transmit the sacred text. So the Masoretes, who are scribes at the same time. So the Masora or Mesora is literally a whole way of living, okay? It's the culture in which costumes, rituals, opinions, beliefs, sacred texts, values, rules of behavior that have been handed down from generation to generation in a group or in a particular community are preserved, all right? So it's not just only text, it's everything that implies that culture. It's everything, it's the collective knowledge and way of living that is faithfully transmitted, that is the Masorah. Of course, today, it's very important, this Masorah, the biblical text, but the biblical text is not equal to the entire Masorah of the Jewish way of living. So remember that this concept was already very well established by the first century. So Paul actually lived with this concept. He was very much immersed in this concept, very much so. So it's quite fascinating then to see that these two coordinates, cultural coordinates or linguistical coordinates in the writings of Paul, the Greek or Greco-Roman culture and the Hebrew or Semitic background combine into, and then we have this Christian notion of paradosis or tradition. In fact, the now Mesorah or Masorah comes from the Hebrew verb masar, which is very common actually, which is a verb that means to give, to transfer, to deliver, to transmit, okay? And this verb usually when it's applied in the Hebrew Bible indicate to transmit a knowledge or a way of living or a culture or a costume from an older generation into a new generation. So it's always dynamic. And this dynamism implies at the same time some kind of preserving something that is already absolute, that is considered to be truth, okay? So that is why these are two coordinates that I would like to explain just briefly that are the pillars of the Pauline spirituality, but also express the pillars of the mindset of the early Christian communities. Remember that everything was on the making, so they need to borrow concepts, notions, and then to apply for the first time to the event of Christ and create there a new culture, which is the Christian culture, all right? That implies also a way of living, a way of religion, a way of relating to God. So far, according to this brief, what we call brief semantic analysis of the text of Paul, just only these two words, then we have this kind of phenomenology of the notion of paradoxes or tradition, which is a dynamic notion that implies two ways, going back to the source, which is the event of Christ, the absolute truth, but at the same time is always implied looking for the future because it has to be transmitted faithfully, facing a changing world, all right? So, and that is actually the great challenge of the dynamic dimension of tradition and according to Christianity. So this is very well articulated. Of course, I present the scripture aspect of it, and there are many other texts that can explain this. I just wanted to show one because it's more than enough as an illustration. But now when we go to the magisterium throughout the 21 centuries that we have of history in Christianity, in the Catholic Church, magisterium articulates this very well. And I would like to use on purpose, which is extremely important, this dogmatic constitution of the Dei Verbum. And please highlight now numeral 7, okay? Dei Verbum numeral 7. I highlight it here for you just in case that later on you want to meditate it. Please consider this. I'm not going to read the whole text. I just highlighted the most important things. I'm going to explain it briefly, all right? So first of all, the vocabulary is very important, especially the one that is used in the redaction of the Dei Verbum, because it implies the history of salvation. So God has seen to it that when it was the perfect time, the right time, God decided, according to his will, to transmit to all generations about himself. So once God wants to auto-communicate himself or self-communicate, so this communication is gradual, progressive. So it's interesting to see here that the Latin version of the Dei Verbum is transmitterentur, which is used in order to translate be handed on, all right? So which is the tradition. The first one to start the tradition is God himself. In the moment that he wants to self-communicate, he handed on the mystery of his divine treasures according to his will in the time that he thinks appropriate. Very important. But then with the plenitude of time arrive, I mean, and that is actually quoting Paul in Galatians 4:4, chapter 4, verse 4, okay? When the plenitude of times arrive, God sent his only son, the Logos who was incarnated. And Christ the Lord, in whom the full revelation of the supreme God is brought to completion, then the mission of the son continued this tradere, this giving himself up. God always gives himself up throughout the history of salvation. And then when the event of Christ is over, you know, historically, in our human presence among us, geographically, and he was ascending to heaven, the Christ, the risen Lord, gave this command. So then his disciples, the apostles, supposed to continue this handover, this traditio, this paradosis, because they need to fulfill the mission of the Son in the human history or in the history of salvation. That's why it's so important, this this statement. This commission was faithfully fulfilled by the apostles, who by their oral preaching, by example, by observances, handed on, tradiderunt, very important. Tradiderunt becomes the most important verb in Latin that is used to translate the verb paradidomi in Greek, and that is tradere. From tradere comes the word traditio in Latin, and of course in English, tradition. So that's why it's so important to say this in the text, all right? But the dogmatic constitution. And what they had received from the lips of Christ, from living with him, please highlight this statement, okay? Because the tradition is not just only the words of Jesus, okay? The ipsissima verba, the proper words that came out of the lips of the Lord, but also the entire event of Christ that implies the sublime revelation of the Trinitarian God. So that is why this text says, what they have received from the lips of Christ, from the living with him, and from what he did, or what they had learned through the prompting of the Holy Spirit. Okay, very important. So the apostles continued this faithful tradition, this knowledge of God transmitted to a changing world, and then the other extension of the apostle will be the apostolic man. So that is why I put apostles and apostolic men highlighted in red. So these are the disciples of the apostles, and then the disciples of the disciples. And of course, it's the church that until today is entrusted to preserve, but at the same time to teach in a changing world, this absolute truth that is the revelation of the Trinitarian God that acquired its fullness of revelation historically is in the person of the Son, the incarnated Logos. So please, I want you to highlight this. So I unpack briefly this notion, which is for us dogmatic, all right? It's already expressed in a dogmatic constitution, in an ecumenical council, Vatican Council II. Therefore, it's an extraordinary magisterium ecclesiae. Okay, so that is why. So first of all, the event of Christ, and I use this expression on purpose, the event of Christ, all right? It's not just only what he said, it's not just only what he did, or what he said and did. It's the entire mystery of the person of Christ, okay, which is the source of the tradition and scriptura, scripture. I repeat, the source, the will, the causa prima, the original cause of tradition and scripture. When we talk of scripture, okay, in the Catholic tradition. So tradition and scripture, they have a common source. This is very important to highlight this, and that is the event of Christ, the person of Christ. And from there, they began to develop tradition and scripture. They are never in opposition. Actually, they are intertwined essentially because they are coming from the same unique source. So the same unique divine well. It's just that one is more comprehensive than the other. Which one is the more comprehensive? That is broader tradition. Because when we go into scriptura, the scripture by itself is the written events of the Lord, what he said and what he did, that in one way or another became canonical. And the moment that became canonical, cannot be changed, cannot be added, all right? And that depositum fide manifested in the biblical canon is essential, but cannot exhaust the mystery. And the Gospel of John is brilliant in this. I mean, if you read John chapter 20, and you go to the end of chapter 20, the text says, Jesus said and did so many other things that are not written in this book. And then you go to the same Gospel of John, but chapter 21. And you go to the end of chapter 21. He said too, the author will say, Jesus said so many other things. And if I need to write everything that Jesus said or did, the whole world cannot contain that. So it's quite fascinating. So already a biblical author is acknowledging that whatever is written in his gospel, and the same goes for the other text, is not exhausting the mystery. It's just only a selection with the help of the divine Holy Spirit and God as an author. So they were selecting the events and the teachings of the Lord in that manuscript. So very important. But the tradition implies so many other things. So that is why I want you to highlight that expression that we say in that we read in the verbum 7. The apostles living with the Lord, with the living Lord, you know, they transmit by living with him, by example, the words, the deeds, and so many other things that imply the entire mystery. And then this notion that is comprehensive of the experience of living with the Lord himself now has to be faithfully preserved, expound, and spread. And that actually is the mission of the church. Ecclesia missio corresponds to the mission of the Trinitarian God that now continues through the church acting in the history of salvation, all right? That is why tradition is essential, crucial to understand the mystery of the mission of the church, the mission of instructing, preaching, educating. So, but also because we are dealing in a changing world and also we are dealing with human instruments, we need to face challenges. It's very important. And this is, nobody can escape from that. So we don't remember that the early Christian communities, they were living tremendous challenges. They were living in a hostile environment, hostile culture against Christianity, very similar to the environment that we're living today, hostile culture against Christianity. But also they were living through a process of everything was on the making. And in doing so, there were many false interpretations of the true event of Christ, of the absolute truth of the Trinitarian God who is revealing. So that is why we have the dangers of false doctrines or interpretations. And that is why the apostles throughout the early Christian communities, they always warn against the false teachers or the false doctrines, or false interpretations that they were manifesting in many different local traditions in the early Christianity and then throughout centuries. So if you go to De Verbum numero 8, it's quite important, the vocabulary that is used, okay? De Verbum numero 8. Therefore, the apostles handing on tradentes, that is the same verb tradere, from which comes traditio, what they themselves have received, always the dynamics, to receive and to give, warn the faithful to hold fast to the traditiones, okay, which they have learned either by word of mouth or by letter, and to fight in defense of the faith handed on once and for all. So pay attention, to fight in defense of the faith handed on once and for all. Now, what was handed on by the apostles includes everything which contributes toward the holiness of life and increasing faith of the apostles of God. And so the church, Ecclesia, in her teaching life and worship perpetuates and hands on to all generations, all that she herself, all that she believes. So it's very important. The essential of the church is interconnected to the traditio. And the magisterium that is formed throughout this tradition is in order to preserve, to interpret, and to guide the faithfulness of this traditio that was given in the event of Christ. Okay, so it's very important to highlight all the mysteries that are interconnected. So pay attention, already there is this warning, because right from the beginning we have challenges in which somebody or a group of people, they decide that this is my interpretation of what is supposed to be the truth about God, and they present that as the absolute truth. And in one way or another, they are becoming God by teaching false doctrines, because then the doctrine or the traditio that is based upon the event of God is becoming the traditio of a group of people, personal agendas, or private interests. This already can be expressed as an example in Matthew chapter 15. Matthew has many examples, but I chose Matthew chapter 15, verse 1 to 6, is because of the vocabulary. So the Pharisees and scribes came to Jesus from Jerusalem and said, "Why do your disciples break the tradition?" Paradoxes in Greek of Matthew is use the word paradosis, okay? The tradition of the elders. So the tradition of the elders is in contrast with the way of living of Jesus himself as his disciples, all right? Because Jesus is actually proposing a new way of living, a new doctrine, a new way of giving himself, which is in contradiction to the paradosis of the Pharisees, the elders, okay? So that is why at the end, here in verse 6, Jesus said, you have nullified the word of God for the sake of your paradosis. And that is actually the great temptation that we have, even today, or throughout the history of the church. There are always groups, always some persons that they say, it's my tradition, it's my truth, the one that has to be superimposed. But no, remember, my dear friends, this is a principle of spirituality. It is not my church, it's the church of God. I am just an instrument. So I need to be a faithful servant in order to preserve faithfully the truth that is given in the event of Christ. It's very important. So I don't have to give you more than examples because we have plenty of them. Just for example, the problem with to defend the sacredness of matrimony. Male and female, God created them. So is a matrimony represent an absolute truth that expressed in the divine law revealed in the Old Testament, then Jesus actually applied to a new level of interpretation, and which represents is in accordance to the natural law. And the natural law is always in agreement with eternal law. So I don't have to explain this, but today actually we find even inside of the Catholic Church, universally speaking, so Germany, for example, or Holland, that defend the opposite to that. So then we have already 21 centuries of tradition that is very clear. So what makes now the difference to say, well, that tradition is not true, now we need to change it, pay attention. So it's quite important then to remember Dei Verbum numeral 8, you know, to defend and even to fight and in order to defend the faith. So it's quite fantastic. The same problem actually you're going to see in the first and the second letter of John, exactly the same problem of false doctrine that wants to deviate from the truth that you have received. It's very important. So I would like to conclude, not my reflection, I present to you briefly the phenomenology of the dynamic notion of tradition. It's always anchored in the absolute truth of the event of God, especially in the event of Christ throughout the history of salvation. But at the same time, this has to be taught. This teaching, these paradoxes have to be transmitted faithfully to a changing world that implies new ways to adapt the mystery. But that doesn't mean that we need to change the mystery. No, we need is to find new ways of communicating the mystery that it will be appealing, that it will be understandable and acceptable to a modern audience. And that is the great challenge, right? But there is a good phenomenon that I would like to explain with the historical journey. And I would like to use two examples. But before that, I would like to teach you, I shouldn't use that word today. I would like to give to you something that at the same time I received when I was a young seminarian last century, actually. notions that we learn in Introduction to Theology or Fundamental Theology of the Gregorian is always to keep very clear, the distinction between tradition with capital T and traditions with small t, all right? Capital T, tradition, and small t, traditions. So two different things. They're interconnected, nevertheless, they're different, all right? So, and ironically, this notion appears very well explained in the Catechism of the Catholic Church, numeral 83. So if you have time, you can go and read it. It's quite important. I read for you this notion. Tradition, capital T, always keep that, is to be distinguished from the various theological, disciplinary, liturgical, or devotional traditions, small t, all right? Very important, please forgive me, small t, right? Born in the local churches over time. These are the particular forms adapted to different places and times in which the great tradition, capital T, is expressed. In the light of tradition, these traditions can be retained, modified, or even abandoned under the guidance of the church's magisterium. Very important, that expression, according to the Magisterium Ecclesia, throughout history some practice or local traditions in expressing liturgy or devotion or even theological conceptions has been abandoned, or they are there, but never continue to be very much in practice, all right? So that is the beauty, but at the same time, the great challenge to have 21 centuries of tradition, right? So let me give you two examples in history of the church, but actually they are very, very good examples to explain this notion, this distinction, okay? Let me present to you the first example, the sacrament of confession or reconciliation, okay? But I would like to aspect the modus, what we call modality, all right? So the modality of express this sacrament. And the other one is the liturgical rites of the Eucharist. So these two examples. Let us begin then with the sacrament of confession or reconciliation. Please forgive me here, it says, or I should write here, reconciliation, all right? So nevertheless, so first of all, let us go to the depositum fidei of scripture, all right? So what we find in scripture, especially one important text in John chapter 20, verse 22 to 23. Which until today is very much so. It's a crucial text, especially when we study today systematically the theology of the sacrament of reconciliation. So we have the institution of this sacrament by the divine authority of Christ himself, who gave the order, the power to his apostles. So, and the text says of the Gospel of John, and with that Jesus breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven. Very important. So we have already a very clear expression of the will of the risen Lord and this kind of transmission of the authority. Right. So, but at the same time, we find other biblical texts like in James or the letter to the Ephesians that indicate that the confession, the way, the modus in which was expressed in ancient times, or really in early Christian communities, had a communal dimension. That means it was in public gatherings or liturgical gatherings, all right? Remember that by the time of the New Testament, when the New Testament was being written, everything was on the making, all right? So, other thing, very important. In ancient times, baptism granted you the forgiveness of all sins, okay, in the Christian tradition, even until today, so it's fine. So if you are baptized when an adult, okay, so all your sins are forgiven. But then after baptism, according to the early Christian modality of the sacrament, can be received only once. So that's it. So those are the only two opportunities that you have, all right? So, but practically for the first seven centuries of the Catholic Church or the Christian tradition, confession and penitential discipline was a public matter. And it was a public matter because it was made public. Everybody knew who was in the process of penitentes, okay? Who was in the process of reconciliation, because it was not just only one single day. It took weeks, it took months, okay? Sometimes even years, right? So pay attention to that. And it was done once in your lifetime. So everything started to change in the Catholic tradition, the Christian tradition, the modality, not the essence of revelation, all right, very important. The essence of revelation remains the same as it is expressed in John chapter 20, right? But the modality, the way how it is expressed throughout history began to change, especially in the 7th century. We have the Council of Chalon-sur-Saône, put the years, okay? Especially in Canon 8, it's expressed that the bishop or the local bishop has the authority to prescribe the penance to a sinner as many times as a person will commit a sin. So that means it began to be established the practice of to do a confession more than once in your lifetime. Very important. And here we have something to say about the Celtic penitential practices from the Irish monks through the centuries. Remember that England and Ireland, they were islands actually. Meanwhile, the Christian tradition throughout centuries were developing, you know, in different areas of the continental Europe and Asia Minor, Northern Africa, and among themselves, even though there are some connections, great deal of differences, how much more to those that are not connected physically to the continental Europe, like Ireland, for example. So already by the 6th century in Ireland was very much in vogue, in practice, the modality of personal private confessions. And they were repeated. That means you can do it more than once in your lifetime. So that is why by the 6th century already in the Irish culture, the monasteries there, you find that confession consisted in confess orally your sin individually to a priest or to a monk, then the acceptance of the satisfaction, which is implied by the order, the prescription of the priest, and then the reconciliation, all right? So already was established. Ironically, this influence with the Irish monks began to come into the continental Europe. This practice slowly began to be developed, accepted by the people of God, and then it became part of the sensus fidei, okay, or sensus fidelium, to the point that became so popular in agreement that the Council of Trent and the 14th session, chapter five on the confession, especially in canon 7, established that the confession, the sacrament of confession, has to be done individually and can be done as many times as the sinner commit a sin. Important, which is actually the practice that we maintain until today. Fascinating. So that, pay attention to this. So the tradition, I mean, the knowledge, the paradoxes that came from the risen Lord to the apostles is this authority to forgive or not forgive, okay? To bound or no bound, right? Okay, on this earth, applying to sins, right? That is the res revelatione, the material revelation. But also we have the other, the forma. The forma is actually the form, the modality in which this res revelatione that cannot be changed because it's actually part of the will of God himself can change. So the forma sacramentis, becomes the disciplinary aspect that through time can be changed according to the guidance of the magisterium of the church. So it's quite fascinating to see this example. It's a typical example of this. Another example, and I would like to finish with this one, so I don't want to tire you so much, you know, because it's intense. And many other examples that can be very controversial, no? But if something will come out in the questions, I will be glad to address that, you know. So for example, the liturgical rites of the Eucharist in the Catholic tradition is very important, as you tell. Remember that the mystery of God is absolute. What we know of God, okay, is always limited. God revealed himself in a sublime manner in the Logos incarnated, but still God outside of the history of salvation, his own divine dimension, which is above everything, is always greater, is always superior. Deus semper maius est, okay? So now the mystery of the Eucharist is so rich. The mystery is so rich that has multiple forms of being expressed. And the expression of the res revelationis. What is the res revelationis? That Jesus himself instituted the Eucharist with these very unique words in the moment of breaking the bread and in the moment of the wine. Very important. Remember the text of Paul from 1 Corinthians chapter 11. So, but that mystery throughout centuries of history of the church has been expressed in many different ways, in many different forms, in many different liturgical expressions. Now, one may say one liturgical expression is less than the other. No. In fact, inside of the Catholic Church, these multiple expressions manifesting in liturgical rites express the richness of the unique mystery that is given in the event of Christ, which is the Eucharist itself. It's fascinating, right? So approximately within the church today, approximately, all right? Because I don't have a very fixed number of those, we can find 23 rites regarding the liturgical expression of the life of the church, approximately, because maybe in the past there were more, remember. Some of them, they came in misused or disused, and then they disappear, okay? Let me give you an example of us, the Westerners, okay? Of those who follow the Roman tradition, Catholic Roman tradition, or what is well-known, the Latin tradition. So we actually, we know very well the Mass that we celebrate, which is the Novus Ordo Missae. So the Mass that we celebrate every Sunday here in Houston, Texas, predominantly is the Novus Ordo. That means the Mass that was established with the liturgical reform established after Council Vatican II and very much promulgated by Paul VI, all right? Which is the Mass that we have. So that is the Latin rite. But that is not the only Latin rite. So always we need to remember that. It's not the only one. And remember that the Council Vatican II practically finished in 1965, began in 1962 and finished in 1965. But also we have the Tridentine Mass, or the Tridentine Rite, which is actually the forma antiquior, very important, I'm very familiar with these two rites because when I was living in New York, I was an associate pastor there. I was celebrating for 5 years, at least once a month, the Tridentine Mass, high mass, always once a month, at least once a month for 5 years. So it was very beautiful, right? Different, yes, but it nevertheless expressed the beauty of the mystery through singing, through the positions of the body, through the attitude of life expressed through the sacrament, through the liturgical celebration of the sacrament that lifts you up to God. So very important. So every rite is an expression of the mystery that help the celebrant and also the participants to be lifted up, to be in this contact or new relationship with God through the liturgical celebration. Very important, very, very beautiful, right? I'm guessing some of you has been experiencing the Tridentine Mass, especially when it became more popular after the motu proprio Ratzinger. I think it was in 2007, right? So, but in St. Agnes, where I used to be a pastor, we had the dispensation already since Paul VI. You know, so that is why before the motu proprio, we were still celebrating the Tridentine Mass every Sunday for decades at the Church of St. Agnes in New York City. But nevertheless, also in the West, and that is very important, it's another important rite is the Ambrosian rite. And I love this rite, okay? The Ambrosian rite is so old that can be established already since the 5th century. Remember, the Tridentine rite, more or less, is since the 6th century, all right? The Novus Ordo is since the Council of Vatican II. So that means since the 20th century, the Ambrosian rite can be placed between the 4th and the 5th century, for sure. On the 5th century was very well established. And that is the rite that is until today, I repeat, until today is celebrated and preserved in Milano, okay? It can be dated even to the time of Ambrose of Milan, when Ambrose was the patriarch or the bishop of Milan in the 4th century. It's quite fascinating because they have this unique way of expressing the liturgy. They have the unique liturgical calendar. For example, the Advent time is longer than us, for example. Or I have been pressing a couple of masses in Ambrosian rite when I used to live in Italy. And it's quite fascinating to see that before the offertory, they do the sign of peace. So it's quite fascinating because that was precisely how it was preserved since the 4th, 5th century. So it's a unique way. So there are many other differences, of course. Another important rite that is part of the West. I'm not dealing here with the rites that we find in the Greek Orthodox churches, church of the Byzantine churches in communion with church, or the Armenian or the Chaldean or the Maron or the Syrian churches in communion with the Church of Rome. I'm not even mentioning that. I just mentioned a few from us, from our Western hemisphere. Can you imagine? So just to give you an idea of the beauty of the different expressions, forma sacramentalis, all right, of expressing that they all of them, they are anchored in the same unique mystery, the same unique matter of revelation, res revelazione, okay? The one is Mozarabic rite, which is very dear, especially to the Spanish, to some Spanish people, all right? It's called the Hispano-Mozarabicum Ritum, or Mozarabic rite. And it's quite fascinating because we don't know this, all right? Remember that the Iberia Peninsula, that means Spain, what is Spain and Portugal today, they were for 8 centuries under the dominion of the Arabs, okay, the Moors, all right? Very important this detail. And they were practically imposing the way of living, the language, the culture. So the Christians throughout the Middle Ages in Spain, they began to develop this kind of expressing their own Christianity through centuries by combining the Mozarabic rites of music, vocabulary, language, and song costumes in order to express the mystery of the Eucharist. The mystery of the Eucharist is always the same, I mean, the core, but also the expressions of the music, the way how they say it, is quite fascinating. And this practice until today is preserved and celebrated in the Cathedral of Toledo and also in the Cathedral of Salamanca. In the Vatican, this rite has been celebrated at least 4 times, as far as I know, 4 times in the Vatican, in St. Peter. It's fascinating, right? So to tell you that is something that is not neglected, that is not marginalized, is actually very much so part of the Roman Catholic tradition. But this tradition that preserved the tradition, capital T, of the mystery of the Eucharist through a very unique form of tradition, small t, in the liturgical expression of the Mozarabic rite or Spanish rite, right? For example, something that I had that experience just before COVID here in Houston, Texas, the Syro Malabar rite. There is a foreign church here in Houston, Texas, St. Joseph Syro Malabar rite. I went there to celebrate mass with one of the associate priests, and then I talk about the Roman Catholic tradition of reading scriptures or interpreting a scripture. It's fascinating to celebrate the mass with them. Practically 90% of the entire liturgy of the Eucharist has to be sung. Everything has to be sung. And the people have to sing too. So it's fascinating to see this kind of dialogue by singing. They have by far more rhythms than us. But the mystery of the Eucharist is quite the same. I mean, the words of the institution, the same, just in a different language. And they celebrate it, you know, the Eucharist ad orientem. So the whole people, in the moment of the consecration, the priest has to give the back to the people and celebrate the Eucharist ad orientem with the entire people of God. So it's very beautiful, right? So it's an autonomous church, Syro Malabar, that comes from the ancient Chaldean rite, that it's practically rooted in the tradition of Thomas, one of the apostles. So every rite has its own uniqueness, all right? So here I would like to tell you that it's a typical example of the richness, but also the difficulties that we have in order to establish, no, what is the right tradition, how to defend the tradition, which traditions are actually deviations of the truth. But that is why we need the magisterium and the intelligence of the church that has been illuminated through our history by the action, guidance, and wisdom of the Holy Spirit. All right. So I would like to finish with this text of Matthew chapter 13, verse 52. The text says, Jesus said to them, "Therefore, every teacher of the law who has become a disciple in the kingdom of heaven is like the owner of a house who brings out of his storeroom new treasures as well as old." Very beautiful, this text. Remember that chapter 13 of Matthew is practically Jesus teaching in parables about the mystery of the kingdom of heaven. And who becomes a disciple of the kingdom of heaven, if it is a teacher, that means a rabbi or a scribe, now he has the authority to learn more in order to continue to readapt the old with the new, but always being faithful to the kingdom of heaven. So, and that is actually the interpretation of Cyril of Alexandria, fragment 172, doing a commentary on this text of Matthew 13. He will say, all of us Christians, we have the obligation, like that teacher, to learn from the kingdom of heaven through scripture, the Old Testament and the New Testament, and now to go for a mission and to teach the truth of God that is revealed to us. Very, very beautiful, very beautiful. With this, I would like to set up my piece, and I will give the option for questions, and I hope that I didn't surpass that was given to me. Thank you very much then.
Father Dempsey, that was a fantastic talk. Thank you very, very much for that. If you'd like to, I'll start off with a question. If you'd like to ask Father Dempsey a question, feel free to just type it into there's a little Q&A button down at the bottom. I really loved that talk, and I felt like, you know, you couldn't, of course, you gave me the title, and I wasn't sure exactly where you were going to go with it. I knew it was going to be very good and stimulating, but I couldn't have asked for a better setup and kind of a doctrinal foundation for this lecture series than that. And I thought you did such an interesting job and an effective way of really kind of explaining these three pillars of, you know, kind of deep in scripture, deep in tradition, deep in the magisterium, as Dei Verbum lays it out. And I think that's even as a department. I mean, if you look around at the specialties and the inclinations and the areas of concentration of our faculty, I mean, this is what we do, you know, scripture, tradition, the magisterium, and kind of leading people deep into that. So next week we have Dr. Summer, who's going to do Benedict XVI in tradition. So as you were talking, of course, and especially talking about these elements of tradition, the magisterium, looking back, looking forward, I couldn't help but think, especially since you're a scripture scholar, maybe you could say a little bit about especially Benedict XVI's project. I mean, we think of the Regensburg Address. We think of his attempt to kind of bring the best of historical criticism into play, but nonetheless, you know, also set up a parameter and a guard against the deviations or the excesses of a historical criticism that doesn't hold fast to the traditions or the magisterium. And how does that kind of tie into it? So,
absolutely.
Yeah.
I want to be very humble here. I got the opportunity to meet Ratzinger before he was a pope, when I was a seminarian, then when I was a priest in Rome. And I went in a couple of his conferences that he was giving at the Gregorian, and also at my Collegio Capranica. He came twice, actually, to give us conferences for us for personal formation. And something that Ratzinger is very interesting is that he followed this very unique mathematical schema. If you read all the documents of Ratzinger, even his personal lectures, he always will start with this basic development. He will tell the problem or the status quo of the problem, if there is a problem, and then he will start a scripture, then the tradition, fathers of the church, and then magisterium. And then after that, the speculation, very important, the speculation. So the speculation, it what tries to do is to elucidate or to articulate the problems that were set wrong, but always respecting the tradition and the magisterium. So it's very important. He always will follow this mathematical schema, which is actually very common, especially in some German circles of Catholic theology. So I used to have professors, mentors from the Gregorian and the biblical were Germans, that they follow exactly the same pattern, because that is the way how they were taught theology, and that is where how we receive theology in that time. So now we need to always to make a distinction. What is tradition and dogma, res revelationis, matter of revelation, and what is speculation? Very important that detail. So usually in biblical criticism, most of the time, at least that is what I found here in the United States, which actually for me was quite surprising until a certain point, is that practically here what counts more is the critical speculation about everything, to criticize everything as a methodological platform, practically denying the tradition of something obsolete or absurd. In Europe, that never happened. Actually, yes, you may propose something new, but always you need to confront, at least in Catholic circles, with what is the tradition, what is the magisterium, in order to compare, because it's important to motivate to the critical exercise of the rigorous reflection of theology, which is very important, but without denying what is actually res revelationis. Because then we need to do what we call, and also the Vatican Council II, the obsequium, the gift, the humble gift of my mind to the intelligence of the church that is illuminated by the Holy Spirit. Okay, so now, for example, in order to answer to your question in a more concrete way, this is actually like a premise, is actually using the books of Ratzinger of the Jesus of Nazareth, all right? Actually, if you read one of them, especially the volume 2, he actually has to address the problem of the institution of the Eucharist, you know, especially the volume in which actually he compares the chronology of the synoptics with the chronology of John, which actually has been a big problem. And he makes some kind of a summary of the results of the biblical exegesis regarding the problem of the chronology and how the tentative to, in order to harmonize them, but also the problems that are obvious there, which is there are two different chronologies. And he leaves the option open. He doesn't give an absolute answer to it, because in fact, you may have now. He proposed a few possible solutions, right? But at the end, it was his clear speculation. It was not presented as a dogma of faith or not. He continued to accept the traditional one. That is the one that we find in the Synoptic Gospels. Okay. Now, in matters of biblical criticism, it is good until a certain point. In the moment that biblical criticism or the opinion of one author begins to destroy the revealed truth or the essence of the transmission of the biblical text, then in that case, biblical criticism becomes actually a problem. And the same goes also for theology, especially in systematic theology. In the moment that critical theology or the opinion of one author becomes the absolute truth, in that moment we are not, if we are Catholic theologians, we can actually not be in accordance with the spirit of the church in this tradition, how to be instruments of faithful transmission and also advancement in the knowledge of the mystery. So I don't know if I answer your question properly.
No, you did. And actually, I think there was a question that came in that I think you answered. So I think that there was one of the attendees said, how can we know when something is being handed on faithfully or when it is being mishandled? And I think you just answered that.
Especially if, remember, always the three columns: scripture, tradition, and magisterium. All right. Yeah. Tradition, sometimes you will find aspects of the tradition that became part of the dogmatic magisterium of the church. All right. For example, let me give you an example. All right. The problem of the original sin. Problem of the original sin. Is not part, the word, the expression, original sin, is not in the scripture. It's not. But the idea, the theology can be found in Paul, letter to the Romans, chapter 5. But the vocabulary is not there at all whatsoever. It took us 4 centuries in some kind of controversy between Augustine and Pelagius in order to begin to talk about grace and the problem of the original sin. So, Do I sin because if my it depends on my will, or there is the original sin because of my propagation of my own nature? It was a big problem. So here we have, in time of great deal of discussion on problems and controversies, which one was true? Of course, Augustine came up with the notion based upon his exegesis of Romans chapter 5 of the notion of the original sin, that later on became the census, later on became in agreement with the magisterium, and eventually became dogma of faith as it was established in the ecumenical councils, especially with Trent. Very important, this detail, right? So, but then what happened with Pelagius? Pelagius has his ideas. As a theologian, yes, he was fine, but did not correspond to the truth that in one way or another was preserved in the event of Christ, that later on, with the intelligence of the church, illuminated by the Holy Spirit through the tradition, do not correspond and was rejected. So, it is not easy, but has to be an agreement, a consensus between a scripture, tradition, and magisterium in order to determine with the mindset of the church. Remember, it's not my intelligence of the mystery. It's the, for me, my humble giving of my own understanding to the major understanding of the church, that 21st century is no more than me. I can't be a theologian. I can't speak 10 different languages. I can't translate the manuscripts or who knows what. But if I am not in agreement, I am not swimming in the same wave of the intelligence of the church. They have 21 centuries of wisdom, experience, and also, unfortunately, mistakes. Then in one way or another, I cannot be superior to that. So my opinion, my theology cannot surpass or override that tradition. So in one way or another, I have the certainty that in the voice of God, the action of God, the will of God is in that wave of tradition that is manifesting in 21 centuries. That's why it's so dangerous. So dangerous. We have to be very careful, especially today when we find bishops and priests defending the homosexual union as a matrimony. Oh, bless you. We have to be careful. We have 21 centuries of tradition saying exactly defending what is eternal and natural law already in the Depositum Fidei. So why today a group of people then in their own intuition, they will say, well, you know, our intuition is the right one. And all of a sudden we put aside 21 centuries of understanding and tradition. Some people will call us, or will call me for thinking this way, a retrograde, or somebody who is immersed in the Middle Ages and some kind of obscure mindset or narrow mindset. But no, I understand also the challenges, but I cannot propose something as truth when it's always a subjective opinion that overrides 21 centuries of tradition. And that is very important, because at the same time, it's an act of humility, intellectual humility. You know, when I teach in my classes, I always say, you know, this is exactly what the magisterium says. But also today, you're going to find this other spectrum of voices that will say exactly the opposite. But it's important also to know the voices that are in disagreement. Why? Because that was the way how Irenaeus of Lyon was doing. So I love Irenaeus of Lyon. So I learned a lot from him. So he needed to know exactly the voices that were around, all the apologetics fathers, you know, yes. Like Athenagoras of Athens. I love that father. That is one of my passions, so to read the tradition through the eyes of the fathers of the church. Mm-hmm. It's fantastic, because then we know that not everything that the fathers of the church says became dogma of faith. For example, St. Augustine, yes. Or the notion of original sin became dogma of faith, but the notion of the limbo never became part of the dogma. So not everything that the fathers of the church said becomes dogma. So it's very important, this detail, but nevertheless, it's part of the tradition. But also, we have to be very careful. The tradition that we have implies also that one that predominates, but also we learn from those who deviated so we don't have to commit the same mistakes of our fathers or forefathers. They're very important, that detail, all right? So for example, sometimes I hear people talking about, I won't say church, about the effort of the will, how through will actually we obtain salvation. So my goodness, that's Pelagianism. But they don't have a clue who is Pelagius, but practically the idea is there. So it's ironic, right? But that is why it's so important, these summer lectures, to learn more. We have the obligation to cultivate ourselves in order to be faithful instruments of the education of the tradition that has been entrusted to us. It is pathetic, pathetic. And it will be a tremendous lack of vocation in front of God if I will create my own tradition, doing a misunderstanding because of my laziness of not studying and present that as the absolute truth of the church. Absolutely not. Absolutely not. That's why with tremor, but humility, I present these lectures because I do the best that I can, such a short time. But my goodness, we have the blessing, but at the same time, the challenge to express, you know, 21 centuries of theology and tradition that, wow, I mean, that is a luxury that no other denominations may have, right? Except for the Jewish, of course, the Jewish tradition. Thank you.
That's fantastic, Father. I'm a fellow lover of Athenagoras, and my favorite Athenagoras, of course, he's giving his apology to Marcus Aurelius, you know, don't persecute us. And my favorite is when he takes this kind of snarky, this is a comment worthy of social media, but it's so glorious in the second century. He says, come on, you don't even believe in these idols that you've made, because if you did, you wouldn't only lock up the golden ones at night. You just leave the clay ones unattended outside. Surely they're not divine. This next question, Father, do you have time for two more?
Absolutely, no problem, go ahead.
So I'm going to exercise my discretion as the director of this series to cherry pick the last comment that came in, simply because we bibliophiles need to stick together and support each other. So Father, do you have any book recommendations related to this talk?
Practically, I created this talk for you, so you are not going to find this any place. So, Dei Verbum is essential. Everybody who wants to talk about Catholic tradition, according to the Catholic theology, Dei Verbum is the monumental text. And it's very easy to read because it was actually, it's very discursive. It's, the Vatican Council II changed the style of writing if you compare with the previous ecumenical councils before, and because it's very easy to read. But and at the same time, we need to find also a commentary of the Vatican Council II, especially a commentary to the Dei Verbum, and they are very good ones. Especially you have to be Catholic, of course, but especially to unpack the different numerals, because they are very much condensed and we don't realize of the technical vocabulary that is used in Latin that became part of the what we call the classical vocabulary in theology. All right, so that is why it's so important, this detail. So if somebody wants to dedicate exclusively to the Catholic tradition, Dei Verbum is essential. Essential. And then with Dei Verbum, after reading Dei Verbum, important is to go to Admitio Agentes, very important that detail. And then if you want to make a connection with the more modern time, it will be Evangelii Gaudium, because Evangelii Gaudium literally is a commentary of Admitio Agentes. And then Admitio Agentes in one way or another is an extension of what is the mission of the church, or lay people especially, or the entire community of the church, as being faithful transmittance, faithful custodians and teachers of the truth that has been handed on to us. So it's very important. So with that, we are fine. Then commentaries that may vary, you know, sooner or later, you may find many different ones, but I prefer go to the source, to the primary source. And in that case, Dei Verbum is the primary source, nevertheless.
Fantastic, thank you. Okay, last question. So you mentioned the importance of transmitting the faith by making the tradition intelligible and attractive. Have you given thought to how we as Catholics can improve how we share the faith through tradition with unbelievers or fallen away Catholics? And that ties in well to your comment on Agentes you just made. So we can wrap up with that.
Yes. So, for example, I would like to mention this. It is a challenge. It is a challenge, especially because we need to accept the truth as it is, to accept the reality that is in front of me. That is a principle in spirituality. You will find it, for example, in Teresa of Avila, but also Ignatius of Loyola. in order to grow spiritually, I need to accept the truth as it is. And the truth as it is that in front of me, I have an environment, a culture that is hostile to Christianity, a culture that is hostile to the Catholic faith, a culture that even among Catholics is hostile to preserve the truth of the tradition that we have received. So accepting that reality as it is, very important step. Then in that reality, which is imperfect, not ideal, then I need to discover the action of God manifesting himself there. And in that action of God manifesting himself there, in the way how they think, in the subjectivism or relativism that they have, to find common grounds, and common grounds that we have some kind of a natural reason, that order of knowledge, in order to present the dialogue of faith with the one who do not believe, or the one who believe until a certain point that cannot understand, to accept the mystery for what it is, that goes beyond the natural order of reason. So precisely to establish a dialogue of faith with the non-believer or somebody who rejects my faith implies a dialogue of humility. Also to listen, to express, but also to listen. And in one way or another, to have the confidence that in that space that we call dialogue, God will continue to perform his action. It's very important though. You know, when we talk about different orders of knowledge, right? The natural order of knowledge, ratio naturalis. We have the other order of knowledge, which is the revelation, supernatural knowledge. It's important to analyze that that is something that appeared throughout the history of theology. The notion of faith, which is a theological virtue, is at the same time a kind of knowledge, a kind of knowledge that goes over a natural knowledge, but doesn't deny it. In fact, faith implies a conviction, a trust that makes me to live existentially with the knowledge, conviction that sometimes cannot be articulated, but is there because it's a gift that comes from the source, which is God himself. So hoping that in that dialogue, and that is exactly what Paul was doing, you know, in Athens, in that kind of dialogue, using the elements of the word in order to take an opportunity, you know, to establish a dialogue, then God will put the seed of faith, because he is the source of faith, no me. So that's why it's an act of humility, that 98% we are going to be rejected, of course, but that doesn't mean that I need to stop, because at the end, I'm not doing it for the other. I'm doing it because I was called to do this. And I need to answer to God, who is the one who actually is the fulfillment of my own life. So for example, it's brilliant, the example of Paul, when he has to explain to the people of Athens, the agnosto theo, the God that is completely unknown, right? And then he began to use something that is part of their own culture to open a window of dialogue. And that is why we have from there the famous Dionysius the Areopagite and the famous communities in Athens. And the Church of Athens today claim with great deal of honor that they are coming directly from Paul. So that was 21 centuries ago. So that is why Paul is so brilliant, because can you imagine Paul having Twitter or Facebook today? My goodness, even the fishes in the middle of the ocean will be proclaiming the creed by now. So it's amazing, no? But the guy, nothing, just with the goose feather and a papyrus. Are you kidding me? And look at what everything that he did. So I think there is so many things that we can learn from a tradition and can be applied today to a hostile environment, is to find this. The great problem is that I want to do my will. Yes, I'm going to speak with people who don't believe in God or the church, and I expect everybody in 1 month to be Catholic. No, because it's not me. It's not me. I'm just an instrument. And I'm speaking out of experience, okay? Speaking out of experience. No, this is not because I learned in a book. Out of experience, when I was doing my missionary work, is to have the patience and the humility and to see that in one way or another, maybe God will do his work through me, but that depends according to his time, his disposition, and the context in which we are, right? So I saw a hand. I saw some hands, but I don't know if you saw it. But if somebody else wants another question, I mean, that depends on Dr. Kirwan, of course.
Sure, we have time for one more. Can you explain when public sins, a historical question looks like, can you explain when the public sins became a more private matter? And do you think it changes our community when it's not public? Interesting question there.
Can you repeat the question again?
Yeah. So can you explain when the public sins became more private? So obviously on your treatment of confession, and do you think it changes our community when it is not public?
Okay, first of all, I think when they talk about public sins, they are talking about public confessions. I guess so.
I think so, yes.
The public confession. So usually public confessions were very common, at least from the first 7 centuries of the church, all right? Why? Because existed in right since the early Christian communities, every sin that I do in private against my neighbor, in one way or another, disconnect me from God, but at the same time from the community. Remember that for them, the notion of the community of faith is an extension of Christ himself. So if I harm myself by disconnecting myself with God in one way or another, I'm also harming the church, the body of Christ. So that is why public reconciliation and public rites of penance, they were very much a common standard in the first 7 centuries in the history of Christianity. Of course, you have to remember that in those kind of gatherings, it was a process in which always it was the authority of the bishop there or the authority of the presbyteros, okay, the priests among themselves. Of course, I mean, they have the notion of the mindset of that kind of people in that time was different from the notion today. Now, I have to say this, and I say this with great deal of humility, and I think that is the way how this question goes. Of course, I mean, for a person who was living in ancient times, to live as a Christian, knowing that I have just only one time my entire life, okay, to reconcile myself completely with God, it was a serious matter. It was a serious matter. So when I will do a confession, my goodness, a confession, a public matter that implies a penitential rite, a way that I need to exclude myself from the Eucharist. And that is what they call up here in a very special way, the Eucharistic fasting, which is very important among the penitentes, very important. We leave after the readings, the receiving of the communion, and then publicly everybody knows that you are in this process of penance, which is at the same time a process of reconfiguration with Christ, a process of reconciliation with the Lord, but also with the community, until the point that actually you are accepted back. And of course, you are practically a new creature with the new grace that has been restored upon you. Now, what happened is when we began to do the transition, and now, and that is something that I experienced myself because I listen to confession all the time. Now, so we actually, gradually through history with the repetition of private confessions, we lost the sacredness of the confession. We lost the most important aspect of this res revelationis, in which a penitent who feels the pain of heart because his heart is contrite, contritus, is actually made into pieces, wants to go back to the Lord through the grace of the church, of the community. Now the private confession that is repetitive is becoming so monotonous, so given for granted, that right now to do a confession does not imply a true contrition of heart with so much sections though. But for example, I have cases for years in which a person will come to do a confession today, and after 5 days will come again to tell me exactly the same things. So I said, well, you know, fine. So, but you already confessed. So there is not a true metanoia, a true change of heart, change of mind, okay? A new repentance to say, I'm not going to do it again. I'm not going to do it again. Well, I'm going to do the effort again. Now it's like a taking a shower or changing your socks or changing your t-shirt. You know, because then I will do it today and then tomorrow I'm going to confession. I'm fine. That's it. So the confession thing, in one way or another, through this repetitive act that we give for granted the mystery of the grace, in one way or another, we lose the sacredness of it. And also we lose a vision and appreciation of what is actually transmitted and what is actually happening there, okay? So unfortunately, yes, I see that there is, actually, we lost something there. But also, we don't have, if today some community or a bishop will say, let us do a public confession, which one person will public his sins in the entire community. I don't think that it will be healthy in our times today. Why? Because we don't have a mature community that will preserve the seal of secrecy, of the sacredness of what is said in that confession. All right. So, for example, let us pretend hypothetically, right, that a bishop today would say, you know, in my diocese, I'm going to do public confessions from now on. And then you have somebody who, with great deal of heart, will present his case, you know, confess publicly to the entire community. After 2 weeks, the entire parish will know about it. And after 1 month, practically, it will be in the news, on the radio, on a TV, because it will be a gossip everywhere. Okay, we don't have this kind of educated community for this kind of aspect today, just I'm talking though. But nevertheless, many things were actually lost, especially the sacredness and the seriousness that imply to go into this process of reconciliation.
Thank you very much.
Answered the question more.
No, it does. I think you did a very nice job of that. I'm remembering that quote from Augustine where he's making the distinction already then, you know, between mortal and venial sin. And you know, he says, well, venial sins, these are these sins we do every day, not like the sins that you see the people doing penance out in front of church committed.
Exactly, the penance. You know? Yeah, absolutely.
And of course, that makes you think, you know, that's certainly a significant incentive, not, you know, to for metanoia, as you say.
Yes.
Yeah. Father, one last question and then we'll wrap it up. So sorry for keeping you. I remember seeing a question on the Teología del Pueblo, I think, and the Method of See, Judge, Act. And yes. Can you say something about that? And then we'll wrap it up. You've given enough of your time.
Yeah, Teología del Pueblo, or Theology of the People. That is actually has something very much connected with the very principle that we have for centuries in the Catholic Church, which is the sensus fidei or sensus fidelium. So the sense of faith that exists in the people of God. Why? Because the people of God, as part of the community of faith, but also as the body of Christ, the people of God in one way or another is a locus theologicus. Very important, that expression, for those of you who study theology. Locus theologicus, that means it is a place in which God is acting and at the same time can be communicating himself through that space, through those experiences. Like, for example, reading a scripture is a locus theologicus, for example. No? So the people of God, the same. So pay attention to this. When there is an agreement between the last lay people of the body of church together with the hierarchy, then that agreement, according to the judgment of the teaching, the magisterium, then that agreement indicates that God is speaking without any doubts throughout that particular manifestation in that particular mystery of faith, all right? So let me give you an example. the example of the Immaculate Conception. The Immaculate Conception. Okay, the Immaculate Conception, you know, practically the 19th century, I think it was Pius IX, the one actually who established the dogma of the Immaculate Conception, 19th century, 1850, 1855, around those times. And he established the dogma of the Immaculate Conception regarding the Virgin Mary. The thing is that was actually a theological problem already since the Middle Ages. That is not new. That didn't happen in the 19th century. It already happened centuries before. But then, for one reason or another, historical circumstances and actually what was actually in the sensus fidelium, depending on the historical context, one way or another, you know, became marginalized or it stopped being a problem until the 19th century resurfaced again. But then it's quite interesting to see then the entire people of God, until the last faithful people in the lay community, but at the same time, the hierarchy of the church, including the Pope, analyzing the sensus fidelium through history, they decided, now we declare in an extraordinary magisterial form this notion as a dogma of faith in our own Roman Catholic tradition. And it's promulgated in a very special way, okay? I think it was a document, the constitutional document of, not constitutional, the pontifical document, Deus in Fabilis. It's very important. So you see something that is already going on for centuries, and then there. Now the notion of ver, juzgar, y actuar, which is actually appear very much in the document of Puebla, already in the 60s, 70s. It's a very interesting methodology in theology, all right? Especially methodology that is very common in the Latin American circles. But people will say, well, that is typical, or that is actually very much something that is new, just only for the Latin American people during the Italian liberation theology. No, no. In fact, that is why it's so important to study what is behind. Always we need to go back to the sources and then from the sources to adapt. That methodology was already in action in the proto-Christian communities, especially remember that the church in the first centuries was 100% missionary church. And that missionary church then began actually the, and that is something that is very interesting in the Pauline theology. Because in the studies of Paul, we arrived today to the consensus that when Paul was actually doing his missionary work, his cities, his itineraries were not improvised. Actually, they were planned. So that implies observation, ver, observation, to see the reality that is in front of me. And seeing the reality that is in front of me, I need to make a judgment of what to do. What to do, for example, Paul in Athens, he made many failures, but then he sees, observe, and then make a plan. Go to the Tower of the Four Winds, okay, in the Areopagus, and then began to teach them. And then action, 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 very important, action, just to fulfill and to act according to what I see, according to what I judge, and according to what the Holy Spirit guiding me according to this pattern for doing his own will. Because all of us, in one way or another, even the spirituality of the Lectio Divina, the notion of the axio to act is always there. A Christian who doesn't live in the spirit, a Christian who, let me put it in this way, a Christian who lives in the spirit of growing to love God is always motivated to act on it, to act on it. If I think that I love God, but I hate my neighbor, my actions also speak. Pay attention to this. Remember the spirituality of the letter of James. So ironically, I wanted to highlight this because I already heard this many times. Not that this Latin American theology of Puebla, or that actually began to be re-emphasizing Escondida and then Dominican Republic, the other documents of the big bishop conference in Latin America, right? By the way, in that one was Francis. Francis was very much active on that. And that is actually very traditional, very traditional. In fact, you take all the great missionary orders, like the Jesuits and the Franciscans, actually they follow the same pattern. But all of us as Christians, we are called to action. We are called to action, each one of us, according to the limitations and according to our vocations and according to the mission that has been entrusted to us. Very important detail. So I'm sorry that I go back too much to the biblical spirituality and the other spirituality, but it's essential though, because in order to talk to the common world, to the current circumstances in front of me, I need to take the old things from the storeroom and presenting them new to the world that is in front of me. And that is actually what Paul was doing. That is actually what the magisterium of the church tried to do. But we cannot, I repeat this with a great deal of humility, we cannot fall into the temptation that in order to get converts or to be appealing to the new generation to abandon our identity and our own treasure. We can never do that. In the moment that we abandon our identity and our own treasure, in that moment we lost actually the core, the essence of a divine world that is the mystery of God that was instructed to us to be faithful custodians. We cannot do that. We cannot do that. So that is why that is the great challenge, because the great temptation is, I would like to be appealing to this. So no, and then we have to be firm. I accept the reality that is in front of me, but that doesn't mean that I'm in agreement with that reality. That doesn't mean that I will embrace that reality. That doesn't mean that I will promote that reality, which is different. But nevertheless, I cannot escape the world in which I am. Because in one way or another, we are here facing these challenges of relativism, chasing these challenges of subjectivism, facing these challenges of the race theory criticism, and so many others. In one way or another, it's because we are called to action to fulfill the mission as custodians of the tradition has been entrusted to us. Very important, very important. And this is not just only a matter of intellectual reflection of theology, it's a matter of vocation. It's a matter of saying, I'm a Christian, I love God. And precisely in one way or another, this is my function inside of this mystical body in which I am part of it, right? I'm sorry, sometimes I get very emotional with these kind of things, but I love it.
Well, we have Father. That was fantastic, and great job, great questions, and excellent job. You know, we have a lot of MA students that are really looking forward to your class on Paul this fall. So I'm sure it's going to be a real treat because you gave us a lot to think about. I couldn't have asked for a better talk to kind of set the stage for these talks that our colleagues will be giving. So I, Father Dempsey, I just want to thank you again so much for
preparing
such a thorough talk, a stimulating talk. I really appreciate you taking your time with us. And these will all be online. I'll send you the YouTube and the Facebook links. So if you want to distribute these amongst your own parishioners or family members or friends, you can do that. But really appreciate it. Thank you so much, Father.
I'm honored and thankful for you to giving me this opportunity. Thank you very much.
Fantastic. We'll see you soon, Father. Have a great summer if I don't see you.
You too. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.